Bring the conversation home to Nigeria as the Agricultural and Rural Development Secretariat of the Federal Capital Territory Administration has confirmed the looting of its warehouse at Day-Day Quarters in the Federal Capital Territory by some residents over the economic hardship in the country. Secretary of the ARD Secretariat, Zakari Aliu, had earlier visited the warehouse where the residents had looted everything in the store and vandalized the place, removing the roofs and windows. He said that FCT Minister of State, Dr. Maria Mahmoud, and the territory's mandate secretary, AGRIC Secretariat, that's Lawan Gaydam, will again visit the facility this Monday, where more detailed information will be given regarding the incident. Well, Arise News analyst Dayo Shobowale joins us now to discuss the impact of the spreading looting spree amidst the hunger crisis and the need for government to come up with appropriate measures to prevent a potential societal explosion. Good afternoon, Mr. Shobowale, and it's great to have you on the program as always.
Right.
Of course, we all begin by condemning this terrible act of criminality, but there's so many ways to unpack it. I'd love to get your take on this.
Well, let us not over-dramatize it. It's a very bad act. But you see, don't let us exaggerate it. I would wish it is a one-off situation. I read a story in the internet about a driver with a trailer of goods who just parked somewhere to say his prayers. And before he came back, they had looted the entire thing. Now, you see, this one was reported as being from NEMA before. NEMA has denied it. The Agric Institute has admitted it. Honestly, I would wish it is a one-off situation. Although it is a normal reaction of people when they are hungry or when they are hungry to loot. So you have to distinguish between the two, hungry and being angry. Or maybe they are in both moods. But you see, looting is criminal. There is no way you can explain it. So I'm happy the Agric Institute man, I said, the minister will visit and they'll put security in place. My first take on it is a form of conceptual analysis. Now we are talking of transparency and confidentiality in terms of where palliatives or foods are kept. You want to know where they are. At the same time, you know, there should be some confidentiality. How you manage that is one thing. Then there's the conflicting concept of accountability, you get me, and adequate distribution. You see, you cannot tell government not to store things if they want to distribute in the future. That is done all over the world. But they must provide adequate security in such a way that when these things happen, they can be accountable and be seen to be transparent in the way they have handled the storage. Before I end up, there's another thing I want to say. I will say that when I was in the ministry, I was an assistant secretary years back. There is a class of people, just like secretaries and so on. You have a class of people, librarians. You have a class of people called stores officers. They are in charge of warehouses, stores. Their ministries keep things they distribute and all that. But you have another set of people cross-checking them. Call them stores verifiers. Maybe those are the people who should be more active now in the storage and accountability for those things in the warehouses. But essentially, speed is of the essence in distributing these things. Speed and making sure that they get to the right places. I think it's because of the problems we have with the minister and with some people in terms of the lodgement of the funds and the distribution. That's why we have this present problem. But now, let me go to my own take on this thing. These things should not be allowed to go rampant. I condemn it, and government should stop it. And it should not be allowed to go up. But you see, I can try to see the mentality behind it. If you have heard of the Robin Hood story and the Sheriff of Shawu Forest, yes. You know, in economics, there's something called Robin Hood mentality, whereby, you see, you tax the rich to benefit the poor and reduce income inequalities. That is the source of this anger and hunger, income redistribution. You see, essentially, when you have democracy, you think you are talking of equal rights, but invariably, the rights are not in terms of income equality. Whereas, theoretically, it should be so. Because you discover that in so-called authoritarian nations, they make sure that welfare is their priority for their people. They go to school, they have health facilities, they are safe here and here. But you see, it does not happen like that. In democracies, where you have liberal democracy or liberal economies, and you have market forces. I've been saying it, and I will keep on saying it. You see, income inequalities manifest more in democracies that run market economies. And they create this sort of hunger and hunger, get me? And which are directed against the system, and which create further insecurity. Because if they do not stop them now, you see, they think these are government vehicles or government institutions and facilities. They can go after private people too. So that's the world. You see, overall, it is creating an amazing nation of massive insecurity. So let's leave it at that.
Yeah.
Let's leave it at that for now.
Well said, Mr. Shibwale. What you said reminded me of a saying by Mark Twain, the lack of money is the root of all evil. But, you know, we do know that we're seeing updates about, you know, security being boosted in those such warehouses and some arrests having been made. One of the recommendations that were made by, you know, some concerned folks were in order to prevent such is swift distribution of such items,
yes,
which entails, you know, ensuring prompt distribution of the items to the intended beneficiaries, developing efficient logistics and supply chain management systems. Regarding this aspect, what would you like to see, you know, to make this actually
I just mentioned it. This should not be stored indefinitely. And that was what I was trying to say when I was talking of...
Yes, but I mean the swift distribution aspect. What do you want to see?
But you have to store them first.
True.
You have to store them and distribute them and make sure they get across to the appropriate people. That was why I mentioned storage, bringing in professional people on storage who can keep account of what is there. So that when the stock, they know the stock it is going, and they know it is going to the appropriate places. You see, the problem on under NIN, BVN, and all that is part of the logistics to make the distribution accurate and swift, and you know, not abuse, so that the appropriate people get what is needed for them to have. That is it. So we are still at it.
Mr. Shibwale, I was listening to an interesting conversation on the radio this morning, and I want to expressly say these are not my views. I'm just conveying a message before you attack me.
That's right.
I made the disclaimer. But, okay. You know, the callers who are calling in, the conversation was about the Red Rail, of course, that we saw being inaugurated last week. And the callers were saying, we don't want to see a Red Rail. We need food. They should give us curry. We don't want to see trains. We can't eat trains. What we need is food. Do you think that there's enough of a balance happening with regards to the celebration of, you know, these great infrastructural milestones? And there's several, in Abia State, for example, we saw the celebration of 24-hour electricity and so forth. Is it really balanced with us seeing the distribution of food, the distribution of palliatives? Because it seems like the conversation is lopsided.
It is not lopsided. And if you had an opportunity, you would have responded to that.
That was my degree.
But rail, transportation, electricity, yes, we all need them. Without electricity, you can't have companies functioning. You can't have people being employed. You can't have goods being made. But people need to eat too. There's the marketplace. Let's go to the marketplace and get the food. Get me? But you see, like I always talk about free education. I've been taught by my lecturers were hostile to me, right, in school. But no, government has come. I mean, so many priorities. Get me? You cannot say because you have free education, there should not be water, there should not be food. Huh? But then, that is the business of government, political management. That is to manage it in such a way that there is no lacuna, there is no hole to be exploited by people like this. That's why I say I pray this thing is a one-off thing. I don't want to join the bandwagon of people thinking it is widespread. I do not believe so. And I'm happy one of the institutions mentioned. I said, no, it's not there. It's another person. But it's not as if they're happy over that. So, imagine a driver carrying a lorry load wanting to say his prayer, and they looted everything. They almost killed him. That's criminality. Get me? Government should handle that. Local government. It's not even federal government. You have local government. The other time when some people were driving things out of Niger State, the governor himself supervised people who stopped them. That they should not take the hand. It's not even a matter of governor now. The local government should look after people in their area. That is where you have the tiers of government, to bring democracy close to the people. But essentially, it's not that I admire Robin Hood mentality, but I would prefer a situation whereby, even as we tax people, you get me? And increase our tax to GDP ratio, we should lessen the inequalities between the rich and the poor, and the haves and haves not. But definitely not through free market economy. Let me put that here.
Talking about the lesson, bridging that gap with the inequalities, like you rightly suggested, Mr. Shewell, are you content with the body language you're seeing from this administration regarding that specifically?
I'm not.
Bridging
there's nothing hidden about that. The lifestyle of the leadership does not show the front wealth, the front power, the front authority, ostentatious is there. Get me? Even in the way that the legislator constructed and arranged, you can see the pomposity there. Compare that with the House of Commons in England. It's like they sit on a bench. You get me? Although you are not alone in that. If you see that of France too, you will think it is an emperor's sitting place. You see, if people are getting enough to go by, it's all right to display wealth. But if they are not, you are inviting their anger, especially if they are hungry.
Absolutely. Mr. Dayo Shobale, thank you so much for this great analysis.